Albanese wages war. And interestingly, this is really the first time that we've seen Andrew Leigh brought into the fold. You know, he's the shadow finance minister and things like that. He's an economist by trade. And he's saying that if we don't raise the minimum wage, then it's going to disadvantage people that are already on the lowest rungs of society at this point in time. Where is there a middle ground with this?
Yeah, I feel for the thousands of small businesses that after 2 years of lockdown, lockdowns where a lot of businesses went under, some are hanging by, you know, the mortgage on their house that they've had to refinance to keep their business alive. They're staring down the barrel of a unaffordable 5% minimum wage increase to pay staff. Some people just won't get by on that. Businesses will definitely go under. It'll add massive inflationary pressures, and the Reserve Bank will basically be left no choice but to increase interest rates. So this is a terrible policy. This is Anthony Albanese kind of being a lapdog to the union movement. They've kind of quietened down compared to their failure of a Change the Rules campaign at the 2019 election. But this shows that that they're still following the unions at every step of the way. And they're in trouble when they have to get Christina Keneally out to try to walk it back. But this would be an absolutely terrible policy for the economy and for the Australian people.
Nick, it's interesting when we saw, not to hark on about polls and things like that, but we saw with News Poll that was published on Monday, you know, the 18 to 34-year-old cohort, which is probably one of the biggest that will be voting for the first time in modern elections, they're predicting that the majority of them will be voting for Labor. How does the coalition spin this to make them aware of the consequences of, you know, if they do vote for Labor and the you know, 5.1% wage increase sounds great on paper, but what is that going to look like when, like, as Evan says, when you've got a mortgage, when you have rent, when you've got to buy lettuce, which is already $5 a head, how's that going to look and how do they spin this?
Yeah, well, that's a very good point. I mean, if you're in the 18 to 34 category, you're really don't know what inflation is. You've probably just known, you know, if you've got a house, you've just known completely stable mortgage prices at sort of 0% or a little bit more than that. So, you know, I just think it is an issue, isn't it? And perhaps the, you know, the lessons of the 70s that we learned the hard way, perhaps every generation's got to learn those for themselves. I sincerely hope not. But, you know, that 18 to 34 cohort is increasingly very soft for the coalition, and that's been a trend in you know, over subsequent elections. So I'm not surprised by those figures. I think the coalition would like to do better in that cohort, but you know, they survive basically by appealing to the middle the middle age group and the oldies, and the oldies, you know, the baby boomers will be a growing demographic until the end of the century at least. So maybe that is where the Liberal Party finds some hope.
Evan, you are in that cohort, along with myself being, you know, in our mid to late 30s, so we really don't know any different. How do we get through to our friends about, look, we don't want to return to where Australia was back in the 70s and in the early 80s and even the early 90s? How do we sort of cut through and say, guys, it ain't going to be all roses on the other side of this election if we do go down this path?
It is a big issue, and as someone with a mortgage, I see it as a big issue. I think a lot of it is the lessons learnt and what we went through in the 70s, 80s and 90s isn't being taught in our schools. It isn't being taught as a problem, really the basic economics of supply side reform isn't being taught as a good thing. We do need to lift productivity in Australia. We do need to engage in productivity enhancing reform. And so the government needs to do more, especially in the education space, I think. You know, again, I hark back to the national curriculum. We need to be teaching more people, young people especially, about sound classical liberal economics, which we're just not doing at the moment.